Alhamdulillahi wa kafa wa salatu wa salamu ala ibadihi alladhina astafa khususan ala afdalihim wa khatamin nabiyyin Muhammadin al-Amin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in wa ba'd. Respected Imam at the SURAU Al-Amin in the district of SETAPAK in Kuala Lumpur in Malaysia, our respected Datu Rosli Sharif, and remember that name, Datu Rosli Sharif, who has worked overtime in organizing this, the second lecture I'm delivering here in this masjid on topics which are very important. Brothers and sisters, it is a very important moment in history, in time, in which we are now located. There's never been a moment in history, in all of history, thousands of years of history, there's never been one, a time like this. No. We live in a unique world, a world that has never been before. No one has ever seen this kind of world before. And those who therefore would simply drink their teh tarik and eat their roti canai and go home and sleep and not bother to think and ponder and reflect over the world in which we live today are people who are disrespecting what Allah gave to them, the faculty of critical thinking. It is our view that Islamic eschatology offers an explanation like no other subject can explain the reality of the world today and of events which are constantly unfolding and now with increasing speed. What then is eschatology? And how important is eschatology when viewed from the perspective of the Quran and the ahadith of Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam? Let us begin with Allah's blessed name. In attempting to answer these questions, what is eschatology? Or in Arabic, ILMU AKHIR ZAMAN. And how important is this subject? We speak slowly because it's the English language. And there are those who are not too familiar with the language. So you will bear with me as I speak a little more slowly than you are accustomed to. And we pray that Allah might take these words into the hearts of the people, that they might understand what has come from Allah's book and from Allah's messenger, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. What comes from me, Imran Hosein, you must never accept unless you are convinced that it is correct. Nabi Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam has just performed the Hajj. It's the first and it's the last Hajj. And after the Hajj, shortly after that, Allah sent down revelation in which He said, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم Al-yawma akmaltu lakum dinakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'amati wa raditu lakum al-islam madina. This day we have perfected for you your way of life, and we have completed this favor which we have bestowed upon you, the religion, the deen of Islam. And we have chosen Islam for you as your deen. So we assume, naturally so, that this is the end, because it's finished, it's completed, it's perfected. What can there be after this? But no, there was a surprise waiting for us. Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam returned to Medina, and he'll never see Makkah again. This is the last time he'll ever see Makkah. There are only 81 days left in his blessed life. And after his return to Medina, two things happened. First of all, even though the religion is perfected, the task is completed, Allah sends down one more revelation. O you who have faith in Allah, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, ittaqullah, fear Allah. What comes after must be very, very, very important. Because this is the last revelation. No more after this. It began with Adam alayhi salam. It continued for thousands of years. And now this is the last one. What is it about? وَذَرُوا مَا بَقِيَ مِنَ الرِّبَىٰ إِن كُنْتُم مُؤْمِنِينَ. The last revelation is on riba. It is the most dangerous of all subjects. It is a poison which, if it enters into your community, your system, would suck you dry, would so weaken you that you become powerless to resist, would enslave you. That's riba. And yet, we never hear a khutbah on riba. Maybe someone should call on the phone to those who write the script for the Salatul Jum'ah, the khutbah, and we shall then read out. This never happened before. This is bid'ah. This never happened before in history, that the khatib had to read a script which was written by somebody. But whoever is writing it, perhaps someone could call him and tell him, oh, why don't you write a script on riba? Because you never hear a khutbah on riba. But this is the last revelation. And in this last revelation, Allah says, if you do not desist from riba, then take notice of a declaration of war from Allah and from His Messenger. If Allah is at war with the money lender, today he's called a bank. If Allah is at war with him, the money lender, and if the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is at war with him, the moneylender, I have news for you. You are also at war with the moneylender. Did you hear that? So if you are at war with the moneylender, we should see some warrior-like responses from you. On riba, at least begin to study the subject. But the fact that this revelation came down when it did is the mother of all warnings. But then something else happened, which is the subject of our topic today. We were sitting in the masjid. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is sitting with us. And a man enters the masjid, he's dressed in all white, his hair is all black. But no one knew him. Well then, he had to be a traveler, musafir, coming out of the desert, because no one knew him. Medina is small. Well, if he's coming out of the desert, he'll have dust on his clothing, and dust on his eyebrows, and dust on his beard. Long, in those days, we used to have beards. But this man is spotlessly clean. So this is a puzzle. This is something strange. This is something mysterious. He's not a resident of Medina, and he's not a traveler coming from outside. Did he fall down from the sky? Who is he? It's mysterious. It's mystifying. It's a moment never to be forgotten. It turns out, eventually we learned that this was Jibreel alayhi salam. And Allah sent him in human form in front of everybody. It's the first time in history that Jibreel alayhi salam appears in human form in front of a whole gathering. Never before. First time. And he came to ask five questions. And they're divided into two parts. In the first part, he asks, what is Islam and what is Iman and what is Al-Ihsan? But in the second part, he asks, when will the last hour come? And what are the signs of the last hour? This is ILMU AKHIR ZAMAN. The second part. In answer to the first question, when will the last hour come? He replied and said, the one who is being questioned has no more knowledge than the one who is questioning. I mean, I know who you are. And I know what you know. So let's leave that subject. The one who is being questioned has no more knowledge than the one who is questioning. Meaning, I have some knowledge and you have some knowledge. And then came the last question. What are the signs of the last day? The last day is different from the last hour. The last hour will come like the twinkling of an eye. So suddenly, and that's it. And the entire material universe will be transformed into something different. غير الأرض, it says. غير الأرض والسماوات, something different. Mountains will become like pieces of cotton wool. And all the graves will throw out their burden. Everybody will come resurrected for the judgment. That's the last hour. But before that, there is another end, and that's the end of history. And that's our subject. When will the world end? I don't know. Datu Rosli Sharif does not know. Your Imam does not know. The Prime Minister of Malaysia, I don't think he knows. When will the world end? Nobody knows. So that's not our subject. But the end of history is when truth will triumph over every rival in a glorious conclusion to the historical process. when justice will triumph over injustice and oppression, and the stars will smile on that day, and the oppressed will no longer weep. That is the end of history. That end of history is characterized by numerous signs. And these are the subject of study in ILMU AKHIR ZAMAN. And because Allah sent Jibreel alayhi salam at the very end of the life of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, after this he dies, this is a sign from Allah that this subject is the most important of all. Do not neglect this subject. ILMU AKHIR ZAMAN. The first sign of the two was very easy to understand and to recognize. We didn't need a PhD from MIT. That the naked, barefooted shepherds would be competing with each other in the construction of tall buildings. My building is taller than yours. Oh, no, 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 no. We got the tallest one of all in Dubai. Oh, no. We in Jeddah, we're coming with one taller than you in Dubai. Huh? This very simple that you would easily understand. That the people who are impressed by tall buildings, and the tall buildings is the symbol of progress. And if kampung, for our listeners in Britain and France, kampung means a village. For if kampung doesn't have any tall buildings, then kampung is backward. So leave kampung and head for where the tall buildings are. This is the sign of a person whose intellectual acumen is that of a naked, barefooted shepherd. What do you mean? I got my PhD from MIT and you telling me? Yes, that's what we're saying. That you now equate tall buildings with progress. You no longer consider what is in the heart to see, is he a man who speaks the truth? He never tells lies. That's important. Because our Prophet, Allah's blessings be upon him, said about Akhiru Zaman, there would be great liars. People will have PhD in telling lies in Akhiru Zaman. So if this is a man who is truthful, who is trustworthy, who when he gives his word, he keeps his word. If he is like, you know, Al-Amin, they gave him that name in Mecca. They called him Al-Amin because he was truthful. He never told lies. He was trustworthy. You could trust him. When he gave his word, he kept his word. This is no longer important, no. You no longer judge people by their character. No, you judge them by their bank account and by what car they drive and which suburb they live in, and how tall is the building. So this was a very easy sign of Akhir Zaman. But then came the second one. And this one was not the same. He said that you'd find that a slave woman would give birth to her mistress, You can't understand this literally. No. This is language which is symbolic. In the Quran, Allah has sent us revelation in which some of the ayat are muhkamat, plain and clear, and others are mutashabihat, that you have to interpret. Similarly, with the hadith, this is mutashabiha. It has to be interpreted that a slave woman would give birth to her mistress. To understand this, you have to understand riba, which delivers slavery. It is riba which delivers slavery. And so my daughter and your daughter is now a slave. That's what she is. In that glorious kingdom called Singapore, which prides itself as the model kingdom of the world. Follow the model of Singapore. So then why Singapore? Why are you so shamelessly enslaving my daughter? As a maid, as a servant. She's the first to wake in the morning, Singapore. She's the last to sleep at night, Singapore. And my daughter works as a slave. She has no vocation, Singapore. And all that you studied in Harvard about the free and fair market, Singapore, you took it and threw it into the garbage bin. Shame on you, Singapore. You make an agreement with Indonesia to pay her $300 a month. Shame on you, shame on you, shame on you, Singapore. Would any Singaporean woman work for $300 a month? Or $500 a month? None, none, none. But my daughter has to be a slave. That's riba. Because you know where the Indonesian rupiah is now. Yes. And you know where the Pakistani rupee is now. Have you ever asked yourself, is this normal and natural, that the money which Allah gave to us, the dinar and the dirham, the gold coin and the silver coin, you know, it's good sometimes to put aside the teh tarik and the roti canai and think. Sometimes it's good to think, you know, before you accept uncritically the paper money, which was not there yesterday. No, it came now. This is the age of the paper money. Because of this paper money and the banking system, riba, she's a slave. So to understand a slave woman giving birth to the mistress, you have to understand the subject of riba. And then, because she is now a slave woman, she's going to be used, her womb is going to be used, and she'll be paid, of course, surrogate mother, to produce a baby for that woman who cannot have a baby. Because Allah created the male and the female the way He created the night and the day. Did you know that? Yeah. Allah created the male and the female the way He created the night and the day. He says that in the Quran. And then having said that, He said, "Inna sa'ayakum lashatta." You are functionally different. But in Akhir Zaman, they say that's nonsense. The Quran is nonsense. Anything a man does, a woman can do. And so the night can try to become day. It's called the feminist revolution. But in the process of the night trying to become day, she's pursuing her own Quran. Oh, very good, mashallah, mashallah. She's pursuing her own career. Nobody ever said you don't have any brains. Of course you have brains. Our mothers have brains, sometimes more than our father. Nobody ever said that you don't have brains. But she's pursuing her career, and now she's going to work in the morning, facing the morning traffic like everybody. And coming home in the evening, facing the evening traffic like everybody. And then you have to buy, you know, the pre-cooked food. Yeah. And the children, put them in a daycare center, put them with the next door neighbor and so on. But because she's pursuing a career in which the night is trying to become day, something happens. She loses her femininity, and in, she even loses her fertility. She cannot have children. So she has to go to a fertility clinic and pay lots of dollars to try to become pregnant. And when she cannot become pregnant, then of course the slave woman. This is a slave woman giving birth to her mistress. But the sperm, which is used to fertilize the egg, has grown so weak because of all the radiation from your cell phones, you saw, and all the internet and so on, and the pollution and so on. The male sperm has become so weak, you cannot produce a male child anymore. So there's only baby girls all around. And the world is filled with women. And so women will rule tomorrow. And so she gives birth to her mistress. Now then, not only did Jibreel alayhi salam come to deliver to us eschatology as the most important of all subjects, but something else he did. He gave us the methodology, how to study eschatology, how to study ilmu akhir zaman. This is the most, the toughest of all, this one. You have to begin with Islam, and then you have to grow to Iman. And Iman is not sold in the stock market, no. Iman is something which enters into the heart. وَعَلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَحُولُ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَقَلْبِهِ. Be conscious of the fact that Allah hovers between a man and his heart. Allah knows what is in the heart, whether there is Iman or not. But then something beyond Iman. You cannot study eschatology with only Iman. The angel asked, what is Al-Ihsan? And the Prophet replied, Allah's blessing be upon him, that Al-Ihsan is أن تعبد الله كأنك ترى. That you should worship Allah as though you are seeing Him. أن تعبد الله كأنك ترى. That you should worship Allah as though you are seeing Him. But wait a minute. Hold it. When Musa alayhi salam went up the mountain, he said to Allah, Arini, Anzur ilayk, show me yourself, I want to see you. Show me yourself, I want to see you. And Allah replied and He said, Lan tarani. Not possible, double it. Not possible. You can't see me. No, Musa alayhi salam. You can't see me. Now with these eyes, you can't see me. But when the companions ask, O Messenger of Allah, would we see Allah on Judgment Day? We meaning, I'm not talking about Barack Obama, I'm talking about followers of the Prophet alayhi salam. Would we see Allah on Judgment Day? He replied rhetorically, so, do you have any difficulty in seeing the sun when it is midday? They said, no. He asked, do you have any difficulty in seeing the sun when it is the full moon? We just had the full moon 1 week ago. This is the 24th day of Shaban, of Shawwal. He said, did you have any difficulty in seeing the full moon? They said, no. He said, that's how you see your Lord. Is there a conflict between Quran and Hadith? The Quran says you can't see him, the Hadith says you'll see him. Is there a conflict? No, there's no conflict. No, there's no conflict. Because the Quran says that we have, in addition to these eyes, that the heart can also see. This is epistemology, the branch of knowledge which studies knowledge and how is knowledge acquired. Epistemology. So when the Quran says you'll never see me, you cannot see Allah with these eyes. And when the Hadith says you can see Allah, it is with the internal eye. So أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه بعين القلب. الإحسان is that you should worship Allah as though you are seeing Him with your heart. So you cannot study eschatology the way you study other subjects at university. Not at all. To study eschatology, to study the world at this time when events are constantly unfolding so strangely, you need not only the knowledge that is acquired externally, but in addition to that you need knowledge which comes directly from Allah to the heart. So when Musa alayhi salam said, you remember? I am the most learned of all men. Do you remember? Shake your head. Huh? I am the most learned of all men. I don't have to narrate the story to you. And Allah says, no, you're not. Actually, Allah is not speaking to Musa alayhi salam. You've got to read between the lines. Allah is talking to a people who believe that they are the elite of mankind. We are the chosen of the Lord God. We are the chosen people. We are the elite. The rest of mankind, excuse my language, the rest of mankind, particularly the Palestinians, are like cockroaches before us. We are the elite. We have the most knowledge of all. So Allah is not speaking to Musa alayhi salam. He's speaking to the followers of Musa alayhi salam, who believe that they are the elite of mankind. And Allah says, no, you are not the most learned. There's one more learned than you. And when Musa alayhi salam meets with Khidr alayhi salam, and I have a little booklet outside, it will only take you 1 hour to read it. It's called In Search of Khidr's Footprints in Akhir Zaman. In Search of Khidr's Footprints in Akhir Zaman. To meet with Khidr, to meet the most learned of all men, to meet the only one who can read the world in Akhir Zaman. to understand what is the meaning of Brexit. What is the significance and implication of Brexit? You need more than an economics degree. You need more than a PhD in monetary economics. You need more than expertise in international monetary economics to understand Brexit. Or, you know what happened in Turkey? The coup d'etat was, which was an unsuccessful coup d'etat. And now, I don't know whether you have this expression in Malay, a Trojan horse. A Trojan horse, you know, you slip the horse inside and you have your soldiers hidden inside the horse. And, Trojan horse. In French, I was told it's called a cheval de Troie. A cheval de Troie. So now Turkey is being prepared to become a Trojan horse for Russia. In order to be able to understand these important events which are unfolding in the world, you need more than a PhD in economics and in political science. Yes, this is the message we're giving to the world today from SURAU AL-AMIN in SETAPAK. This man who is sitting on a rock, Khidr alayhi salam, he was sitting on a rock because he's not sitting on the shifting sand. He doesn't change his opinion to suit the way the wind is blowing, so that his name does not go on a no-fly list. You know, so that his business is not threatened. So that the world does not say he's a terrorist. No, he doesn't care. He doesn't care for that. He's firm like a rock. You can't shake him. Not even with a bulldozer. That's the kind of scholar you need in Akhir Zaman. Not the one who is concerned about maybe I lose my salary, I lose my job, I lose my promotion. Yeah? The fellow who is preparing the paycheck might not prepared for me if I give a wrong khutbah. He sits on a rock. That's the scholar you need if you want to penetrate Akhir Zaman. More than that, Musa alayhi salam, you know where to find him? You'll find him at Majma'ul Bahrain. You'll find him at the place where the two oceans meet. Is it Atlantic and Pacific? No. This is Mutashabiha. The two oceans are the ocean of knowledge, externally acquired. And that you get from the universities. And the ocean of knowledge, which is internally received. And that you'll only get if Allah puts Noor in your heart. And Noor is not sold in the stock market. And you cannot have Noor in your heart if you tell lies. Monstrous lies. Shameless lies. These people got PhD in telling lies. They started long before 9/11. When 9/11 took place, I said, well, you know, there are three kinds of lies. There are normal lies, and then there are great lies, and then there's 9/11. I thought this was the biggest lie of all. But they've been constantly lying, shamelessly lying, and then go to church on Sunday morning and pretend to be a civilized people. So this man is to be found at the place where the two oceans meet, Majma'ul Bahrain. the ocean of knowledge externally acquired and the ocean of knowledge internally received. And if you want to get knowledge internally, you must have nur in the heart. And that nur comes only when there is sincerity in the heart. The heart must be for Allah. There's a beautiful hadith. My teacher, Maulana Dr. Muhammad Fadlur Rahman Ansari Rahimahullah, gave it to us. That Allah's messenger said, you must memorize it. Man kana lillah, kana Allahu lahu. Whosoever is for Allah, Allah is for him, Allah is for her. Man kana lillahi, kana Allahu lahu. In addition to that, the one who will receive nur from Allah must direct attention to establishing a proper relationship with Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, because he is nur. قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ نُورٌ وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ. There has come to you from Allah a nur and this book, a nur and this book. So Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam is nur. Follow him. Be careful. Don't part company from him. Because if you step away from him, you're going to lose nur. And on finally, if you want nur, you got to go to the Quran. Allah is nuru samawati wal ard. And the Quran is the kalam of Allah. So every word in the Quran is a window to nur. If you're not reciting the Quran every day and completing the entire Quran from cover to cover at least once a month, how can you expect nur? Not only does this man have the two oceans of knowledge, but more than that, it is Majma'ul Bahrain. The two oceans come together to be harmoniously integrated. I don't think any university can do that. No. That you have two oceans of knowledge and the two oceans come together to be harmoniously integrated as a whole, that is the most learned of all men. Khidr alayhi salam. So not only did the angel come to tell us how important is eschatology or ilmu akhir zaman, the angel also came to tell us what is the way, what is the method for studying this subject. When we look at the world today, we find, as I said earlier, that it is a unique world. There's never been a dunya like this before. And the most puzzling thing about this dunya today, and I have to speed up a little bit now, is that there's an actor at work on the stage of the world. And he is an actor who seems to have come out of nowhere. We had great civilizations. Babylon was a great civilization. The Aztecs in Mexico, a great civilization. China, a great civilization. Where did this fellow come from? The Christian world, the Hindu world, the Buddhist world, the Muslim world, great civilizations came to the world. And then suddenly, out of nowhere, an actor appears. And he takes control of the world. Who is he? Is this happening by accident? He has a power that none can resist. He brings a scientific and technological revolution which, when applied to military science, gives him unprecedented power. No longer is he dependent on the wind for a ship to sail. No. He now has nuclear-powered ships. He doesn't travel by horses anymore. He has mechanical transport on land. He has motor cars. He has trains to take goods a long distance, which yesterday was camels. This fellow even travels in the sky. We never had it before. He has an aeroplane that flies in the sky. He doesn't need a sword anymore to fight. He can kill you from a distance. Huh? Strange. He has unprecedented power, military power. But unlike Zulkarnain, who had faith and who used power, Surah Al-Kahf? Huh? Surah Al-Kahf? You must shake your head a little bit. Surah Al-Kahf. Zulkarnain used power to punish the oppressor and to bring relief to the oppressed. And Zulkarnain used power to help those who have faith and who are righteous in conduct and to reward them. But this fella is the opposite of Zulkarnain. This fella is essentially godless, And he uses his unprecedented power to oppress like no oppressor has ever been. And he uses his unprecedented power to target those who have faith and who are righteous in conduct. It doesn't matter whether you are Christian or Muslim or a Jew or a Hindu or a Buddhist. It doesn't matter. Once you want to be truthful, once you have integrity and you stand up for the truth, once you are righteous in your conduct, this man is coming after you. Who is he? He comes and uses his power to oppress, and he wants to take control of the whole world. In Mr. Putin's beautiful expression, Vladimir Putin, the Russian president, he said about this man, he has imperial ambitions, which is very dignified language. He wants to rule the world. This fellow embarks upon an effort to rule the world. But we find him moving through three stages, and I gave this lecture right here in this SURAU just before Ramadan. And Allah spoke about it in the Quran in Suratul Mursalat. Allah says, "Intaliku ila zillin dhi salati shu'ab." Proceed now, the world now proceeds to a shadow which will manifest itself in three stages. In Akhir Zaman. It was not possible for anyone to interpret this ayah until the world experienced Pax Britannica. And then Pax Americana. You cannot explain Pax Britannica with any of the tools of political analysis. No, none. You cannot explain the passage from Pax Britannica to Pax Americana using the tools of normal political analysis. No, not at all. The passage from Pax Britannica to Pax Americana and the role of the Bretton Woods Accord and the emergence of the International Monetary Fund, which meant goodbye to His Majesty the Sterling Pound. Goodbye to Britain. Goodbye to Pax America, Pax Britannica. And now it's time to say goodbye to the US dollar. But if you are studying the subject from eschatology, you would know that Brexit means goodbye to the euro as well. That we are now located at a moment in time when the entire monetary system is collapsing. And the speed at which it is collapsing is frightening. I don't know the speed, but I have a friend, I don't want to reveal his name. He is a deputy governor in one of the central banks of the Muslim world. He might listen to this lecture, so let me be careful with my language. And my friend shared with me that the speed at which it is collapsing now is alarming. And tomorrow it's only gold and silver that will help you. Tomorrow it's only dinar and dirham that will help you. Because the whole thing is going to collapse. And Pax Americana will give way to Pax Judaica. How did we know this? How did we know this? This is in my book, Jerusalem in the Quran, which was written in the year 2000. 16 years ago, I wrote that book in New York. Where did I get the knowledge from? That the US dollar is going to collapse? I've been saying this for 20 years or more now. This is eschatology. That you get the capacity to analyze events occurring in the world. Because you know that there is a fella, a mastermind at work, who wants to rule the whole world. And he gave us his first stage of his shadow that Allah spoke in the Quran with Pax Britannica. And the second stage of the shadow was Pax Americana. And we are saying that the third and last stage of the shadow is going to be Pax Judaica. When Israel will seek to replace the United States of America as the next ruling state in the world, and Israel is going to say, away with all of this godlessness. This fellow is not only godless, this fellow is also decadent. He is the one who says a man could marry another man and get a marriage certificate. You know who the fellow is? Modern Western civilization. So Pax Judaica is going to come to say, we want to sweep away all this godlessness and all this decadence. We want to turn away from all of this oppression and so on. We want to bring back the world, bring it back to religion, bring it back to the worship of the God of Abraham. Oh, it's going to be very, very, very interesting, eh, tomorrow? If we are alive and this drama unfolds, as they say to the world, we must come back to religious values. This is Pax Judaica. But their oppression will be greatest of all, because they want to rule over everybody. And eventually a man will stand up in Jerusalem and declare I am Al-Masih, the Messiah. But he would not be Al-Masih, the Messiah. He would be Dajjal, the false Messiah. In order for him to achieve his objective, a Pax Judaica, for Israel to rule the world, he has to make Israel very, very big, like the United States, but that's not possible. Israel cannot expand. Israel is surrounded by the Arabs. Forget it. Or the world has to become much smaller. Which one will it be? Which one will it be? Yes? The answer is, the world will have to become much smaller. And that's why we're going to have nuclear war. They want the nuclear war. They know it. And they've already prepared for nuclear war with the underground bunkers and so on. So they will survive. In order to have the nuclear war, they got to provoke Russia. So Russia had to become a nuclear power. And that's why they transferred nuclear technology to the Soviet Union. Yes, so that the Soviet Union could become a nuclear power, so that tomorrow there could be nuclear war, so that the world will become small. Are you beginning to understand now what's happening in the world? The next event that is about to occur from our eschatology is the Great War. Let me quote the hadith that the Turkish government is not comfortable with. And the Ottoman Empire wished that this hadith could be rubbed up and put away. Nobody read it. Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam is talking to his companion Mu'az ibn Jabal radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And they're sitting next to each other. His hand is on his shoulder, I think. And he said to him, about the signs of Akhir al-Zaman. Qumranu Bayt, the hadith is in the Sunan of Abi Dawood. And he says to him, Qumranu Bayt al-Maqdis, when Jerusalem is center stage and flourishing, built up, Kharabu Yatrib, at that time, look to Medina and you see Medina in forlorn dissolution. Nobody, no event in Medina, nothing. It plays absolutely no role whatsoever, even in Arab affairs. Kharabu Yathrib Khurujul Malhama. When that occurs, which is where we are now, then look for the Malhama. The Malhama is a great war. The Malhama is not just a great war. It's a war like no war has ever been. None. First time. What kind of war will it be? The Malhama. Hadith in Sahih Bukhari that 99 out of every 100 of the combatants will die, will be killed. 99% will be killed and only 1% will survive. I hope NATO is listening. If you're in the US Armed Forces or if you're in the British Armed Forces, please stop and listen to this lecture, because your chiefs will not tell you this. When you attack Russia, listen, 99 out of every 100 will be killed. This does not happen in conventional warfare. No. The only way that 99 out of every 1,000 can be killed is if it's a war with weapons of mass destruction. Among the weapons of mass destruction that we know of are nuclear weapons and thermonuclear weapons, but there could be others that we don't know about. So don't send me any emails on the subject, please. Thermonuclear weapons, weapons of mass destruction is enough. That's what is in the hadith. And each one will say, I will be the one who would survive. Meaning, they're going to enter into this war not knowing whether they're going to win or not. There'll be uncertainty when they enter into the swamp. My opinion, and when I give an opinion, of course, never accept it unless you're convinced that it is correct. My opinion is that the NATO is preparing for war with Russia. And I'm not the only one who holds that view. There are many others. And the war is around the corner. And when once that war takes place, it is inevitable that it would eventually become nuclear war. We don't know whether it will start as nuclear war or whether it will be a conventional war which will eventually become nuclear war. We don't know. I'm not a prophet. I don't have an angel speaking to me, no. We know that the war is going to come soon, because the longer they wait to attack Russia, the stronger Russia becomes. And the nice thing, the wonderful thing that makes our hearts so warm is that Russia is not afraid of them. If Russia is standing up against the oppressor, then why can't you see that you should support the one who is standing up against the oppressor? Why are you continuously blind? What can I do to wake you up? Russia knows that nuclear war will destroy Russia. They know that. But the Orthodox Christian Russian people are not afraid of death. No. No one is saying to Putin, be careful, we don't want nuclear war. No, the Russians are not doing that. If an Orthodox Christian is not afraid of death, why should a Muslim be afraid of death? If an Orthodox Christian is setting the example of courage in standing up to the greatest oppressor that the world has ever known, why can't a Muslim be the same? What's wrong with the world of Islam? Why have we lost our courage? We should not be afraid to die. A Muslim is not afraid to die. And tonight, from Surau Al-Amin, we say to NATO, even if millions of us have to die, we don't mind. We want the oppressor to bite the dust. Before we end, Islamic eschatology not only explains these events unfolding, like the collapse of the monetary system that's coming around the corner. When your paper money can be used, you know, as wallpaper. And the only money that there'll be in the world will be electronic money, digital money. So you don't need any money changers anymore. There's only one money for the whole world. It's invisible money, it's intangible money. You can't take it out of your bank account. And if they don't like you, guess what they'll do to your account? They'll freeze it. Yeah, you have no money. And then you come to me to complain? No, no. If you're sensible, you do like the Naqshbandi, the Sufi order, the Naqshbandi. The Naqshbandi are telling their people to keep dinar and dirham. Sheikh Nazim, rahimahullah, who died a few years ago, he ordered all his followers to keep dinar and dirham. Very sensible, very sensible. The Naqshbandi, I am told, are going into the countryside and farming, organic farming. Very sensible, very sensible. I have to pause now because I get lots and lots of emails. I get them from Belgium, I get them from France, I get them from Britain, I get them from the United States, I get them from Algeria, I get them from Morocco, all over. Sheikh, 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 where is the Muslim village? We want to come and join the Muslim village. We want to leave this godless world and come and live in the Muslim village. Well, the answer is, well, my students in different parts of the world, they buy land and they put animals on the land and they're doing some farming, but none has built the villages yet. But let me tell you the story of one of my students. He's Malaysian, eh? And he's the only one to have done it so far. He sold his house in KL. He gave up his job, which had riba. He looked on the internet and he found land, which was cheap. And he bought 1 acre, cheap. And he went and built his house. He didn't get a contractor, no, he bought the material and he employed the men and built the house. He planted rice. He planted date palms, different kinds of date palms. He planted fruit trees. His 1 acre has now become 6 acres. He has goats. He has chicken. He has ducks. He has horses on his land. It's only about 1.5 hours out of KL. But to get to this land, there was a road where only a motorcycle could go. That's why it was so cheap. And he built it up, so now a motor car can go. And I went 2 weekends ago to this brother with a wife and me, mashallah, mashallah, mashallah. He could not have done it if he didn't have the support of his wife. His wife has been at his side supporting him, yes, mashallah. And they're a young couple with a son about 5 or 6 and a daughter about 2 or 3, that's it. And only a few villagers living around there, some distance away, small kampung. But a beautiful spot where he is. And when you go there, you don't want to go back to KL. So why don't you do that? Instead of sending emails to me from France and Britain, Sheikh, the Muslim village, why don't you do what this brother has done? Sell your house in London. Yes, sell your house in London. Give up your job, make hijrah. Go look for the countryside where land is cheap. The land on which he's planting his rice, he bought for 10,000 rupees, sorry, 10,000 ringgits an acre. It was swamp land, he had to fill it up, but 10,000. So that's what you can do in preparation for nuclear war. You have to stock up on food. You have to stock up on water. You have to stock up on energy. He has a well, a tube well. He's going to use solar energy to bring the water up. But in addition, he's sensible. He has a hand pump. So if the solar energy doesn't work and there's no electricity, he can still get water using a hand pump. This is how you prepare for nuclear war, by getting out of the city. Getting out of the city, because the cities are going to be anarchy when nuclear war takes place, because there will be no food and no water, and no gasoline for your motor car, no transport. Instead of seeking to run away from death, you must have it in your heart. No, I continue the mission of Islam. I'm not running away from death. Allah gives life and Allah takes life. But I have a duty to try to protect my family as best as I can, and that's why I'm moving to the remote countryside. Before I end, not only does Islamic eschatology explain the events which are unfolding in the world, like nuclear war, like the collapse of money and so on. One world government ruling you from all over, only one world government. Islamic eschatology also tells you what's coming tomorrow. And the most important event to come after the Great War, he said, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. He said, khurujul malhama. Who is he speaking to? Ma'az ibn Jabal. Hadith in Sunan of Abi Dawud. He said, khurujul malhama, fathul Constantinia. That the next event to occur after the Great War or the Malhama would be the conquest of Constantinople. That is why they changed the name to Istanbul. Not only did these wicked people, wicked people with a capital W, not only did these wicked people change the name from Constantinople to Istanbul to hide the subject, they did more than that. They prohibited the use of the name Constantinople. It's against the law. So tell Mustafa Kemal to get lost. And all those who honor him and respect him to tell him, get lost. Because if Nabi Muhammad alayhi salam used the name Constantinople, then it is sunnah. And you cannot prohibit a sunnah. You must be crazy. The conquest of Constantinople takes place after the Malhama. So it's a lie that they told 600 years ago, the Ottomans, that the Ottoman conquest of Constantinople in 1453 fulfilled the prophecy of Nabi Muhammad alayhi salam. That's a lie. The Malhama has not taken place as yet, Sultan Muhammad Fatih. Why are you lying like this? Yeah, you're a liar. They honor you, we say they honor you in Turkey, and we say you're a liar. Because the conquest of Constantinople, prophesied by Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, is still to come. I know it's going to give headaches to NATO. I know NATO is scared now when they listen to lectures like these. Because this is Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam speaking. This is not Nawaz Sharif speaking. It's Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam speaking. What happens after the Malhama? What do we do? Those of us who die are the lucky ones. I hope and I pray that I am one of the lucky ones. We die. Even if you die before the Malhama, you are lucky. This is a nice time to die. This is a good time to leave the world. After the Malhama is going to be a terrible world. Those who survive the Malhama, I don't know how you're going to live. No sunlight. For I don't know how many days, no sunlight. But this is the message that we give from Islamic eschatology. And may Allah take these words of mine all over the world. That if you see, if you live to see the Malhama, and if you survive the Malhama, then Imran is saying to you, on the basis of the prophecy of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, if you are young enough and strong enough to fight, then make some preparations for your family and head for Constantinople. Wherever in the world you may be, give up everything else. Leave Indonesia. Leave Malaysia. No government can stand in your way. The followers of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam all over the world, as soon as the Malhama takes place, are going to head for Constantinople. Because he said, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, لَتَفْتَحَنَّ الْقُنْسْتَنْتِنِيَّةِ. You will most certainly conquer Constantinople. وَلَنِعْمَ الْأَمِيرُ أَمِيرُهَا. What a wonderful commander will that be of that army. وَنَنِعْمَ الْجَيْشُ ذَٰلِكَ الْجَيْشُ. And what a wonderful army that would be that will conquer Constantinople. But there are, both in the Quran and in the Hadith, indications that we will conquer Constantinople on the basis of an alliance with Orthodox Christians. It will be a Muslim Christian army that will conquer Constantinople. Which Christians will this be? Does Allah speak about Christians in the Quran with whom we could have such a relationship? Shall I remind you? Yes, it's there in the Quran, but we don't take time to study the Quran. No, we have too much time in the traffic in KL to study the Quran. وَلَتَجِدَنَّ أَقْرَبَهُمْ مَوَدَّةً لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّا نَصَارَى. And you'll most certainly find in time to come that those who will be closest in love and affection for you would be a people who proclaim, we are Christians. That couldn't be British and American and French Christians, because they hide their religious identity. They secularize their religion. It has to be a different kind of Christian who proclaims my identity. I am Christian. It can only be the Orthodox Christian. That's not all. ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ مِنْهُمْ كِسِّسِينَ. You know these Christians because they still have the ulama. The institution of the ulama is intact, and the ulama have a status in society. In that Christianity out there where a man could marry another man and get a marriage certificate, the priest is the laughing stock of the world. In this Christianity out here, Orthodox Christianity, the ulama or the priests still have a status, high status. ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ مِنْهُمْ كِسِّسِينَ وَرُهْبَانَ. There'll be another way you can recognize these Christians. What is it? They still have monasticism. In Britain and in France and in the United States and Canada, the monastery is now McDonald's hamburgers or Kentucky Fry or Pizza Hut. There are no more monasteries. The monastic way of life is gone. But in this part of the Christian world, the monastery is still there. The monk still has an important place. The monastic way of life is still treasured, which is why Kosovo is such a difficult problem. Because Kosovo is the heart of the monastic life of the Orthodox Christian. And the Ottomans knew that. And Bill Clinton knew that very well at Daytona. Oh yes, he knew it. They're devils. So this is the Christian who will be the closest in love and affection for you. But one more thing by which you can recognize this Christian with whom you will make an alliance. وَأَنَّهُمْ لَا يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ. They're not an arrogant people. The British, the French, the American, the German, the Canadian, they want to rule the world. They want us to all become carbon copies of themselves. So if you serve me curry, fish and rice, and I roll up my sleeve and I wash my hands, and like a good Malay, I eat with my hand, my fingers. That's the only way you could eat curry, fish and rice. They say, what a barbarian he is. This is uncivilized. You should eat the way we eat with cutlery. Yeah, curry, fish and rice with cutlery. You must dress the way we dress. Take off that dirty beard from off your face. A civilized man is clean shaven. A civilized man wears a shirt and trousers and jacket and tie. I say that's arrogance. And there are many who say the same thing as that. That's arrogance. I went to Russia. And when I went to Russia, I saw lots of beards. Oh, yes. Lots of beards in Russia. These are not an arrogant people. They don't want to rule the world. They don't want to transform all of mankind into carbon copies of themselves. وَلَنْ تَرْضَى عَنْكَ الْيَهُودَ وَلَنْ نَصَارَ حَتَّى تَتَّبِيَ مِلَّتَهُمْ. No, that's those Christians. These Christians are different. So Allah is telling you as plain as a billboard on the road to the airport. These are the Christians who in Akhir Zaman will be closest in love and affection for you. And you have to build alliances. He says that. He says, Al-Kafiruna ba'aduhum awliya'u ba'd. The kuffar are constantly building alliances amongst themselves. Shall I repeat it? Al-Kafiruna awliya'u ba'aduhum, ba'aduhum awliya'u ba'd. The kuffar are constantly building alliances amongst themselves. Illam tafa'alu, if you do not do the same, if you do not reach out to build alliances with the non-Muslim people who are closest in love and affection for you, illam tafa'aluhu takun fitnatun fil ardi wa fasadun kabir. If you do not do that, there will be fitna and great fasad in the world. Is it not time for us to listen to Allah? Is it not time for us to listen to the Quran? Is it not time for us to turn to the Quran, that the Quran will help us to prepare for the events which are still to come, in which the conquest of Constantinople is the most important of all? The hadith then ends, Fathul Constantiniyah, Khuruj al-Dajjal. Which hadith? The one with Mu'az ibn Jabal, quoted in the Sunan of Abi Dawood. Yeah. The end of the hadith, Fathul Constantiniyah, Khuruj al-Dajjal. That after the conquest of Constantinople, only then will Dajjal make his appearance in human form. Prior to this, Dajjal is already in the world, but you can't see him. But he waits until the conquest of Constantinople to make his appearance. Why? Because now it's there around the neck of Israel. Israel can't get away now. Finish. Dajjal took them for a ride. It's the last ride on which they'll ever go. And now they'll face the end that Fir'aun faced when he was drowning. They will end the same way that Fir'aun ended. That the end, when they're being destroyed, defeated, and the rocks and the stones will speak and say, Muslim, there's a Jew hiding behind me, come and kill him. That's the end of Israel. They will now realize the truth that Fir'aun realized underneath the water. And they will die accepting that truth, as Fir'aun died accepting the truth and knowing you're going into the hellfire. And that's why Allah preserved the body of Fir'aun. The body was discovered when? In 1898, just after the Zionist movement was established. The sign for the world that the events which will now unfold in the world would be a repeat. The world history will repeat itself. that the epic encounter between truth and falsehood between Fir'aun and Musa will now be reenacted in the historical process, and history will end the way it ended, underneath the water. This is Islamic eschatology, and I pray that Allah may bless all those who now in their hearts get a fire. I want to study this subject. It's more important to me than a PhD in business management. I want to study this subject. I want that Allah should help me that I get the knowledge with which to be able to understand the reality of the world today, using the Quran and using the hadith of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Rabbana taqabbal minna innaka anta samir alim wa tub alayna ya maulana innaka anta tawwab rahim bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahim. Amin. We have some time before Maghrib. Should we have questions? Okay. Dr. Rosli is in charge. And Dr. Rosli says you have a chance to ask any questions you want. Yeah. Number one. Only one question. One. The question is, you would like us to study Islamic eschatology or ILMU AKHIR ZAMAN, but when we study the subject, what's the method by which we could teach it to others? Okay. My latest book, just published 1 month ago or 2 months ago, is called Methodology for the Study of the Quran. I don't have a volunteer as yet to translate it to Bahasa, Malaysia. We have someone translating it to Bahasa Indonesia. So would Bahasa Indonesia work here? If we publish it? Indonesia? Because I'm not getting any volunteer to translate it to Bahasa Malaysia. But suddenly I found, strangely, I found many Malay people who know the English language prefer to read the English than the Malay. Yes. So I would suggest to you, study that book, Methodology for Study of the Quran. The method of teaching eschatology is different from other subjects, because Khidr alayhi salam made a distinction between the student who comes all puffed up, you know, I am the elite of mankind, the Jews, Banu Israel. And Khidr alayhi salam said, you can't be my student. No. إِنَّكَ لَن تَسْتَتِيَ مَعَيَّ الصَّبْرَ. You can't show patience with me. وَكَيْفَ تَصْبِرُ عَلَى مَا لَمْ تُحِدْ بِهِ خُبْرًا. And how can you be patient in respect of that knowledge which lies beyond your capacity to comprehend? How can you be patient in respect of knowledge which lies beyond your capacity to comprehend? وَكَيْفَ تَصْبِرُ عَلَى مَا لَمْ تُحِدْ بِهِ خُبْرًا. If you want to study with me, then my condition is, don't ask any questions. Don't ask me any questions. A teacher doesn't teach that way. No. A teacher has to be showing and guiding his student gently and being patient with the student. But this Khidr is saying to Musa alayhi salam, don't ask me any questions. No, I will explain to you. Cutting him down to size. When you teach ilmu akhir zaman, the methodology of teaching is that when you find people who are uncomfortable with you, who are in doubt concerning what you are saying, then say to them very plainly and clearly, and don't do it with any arrogance and pride, just say to them, please don't accept anything I say unless you're convinced that it's correct. And there are many other scholars, go to them. When on the other hand you find a student in whose heart there is hunger, there is humility, he does not consider himself puffed up with pride. And secondly, this is a student who is not like a sponge. Anything you say, he accepts it. That's a dangerous student. Huh? This is a student with critical thinking. And he critically analyzes whatever is taught. And only when he is convinced that it is correct, then he accepts it. Oh, now you have a student. And when you find such students, then even if you have to spend your days and nights teaching them, this is the one to teach. Any more questions? Yeah. One, two, three. One, two, three. Yeah. No, no. The question is, he's speaking about a book of hadith and he wants to know whether this is a reliable source of information. No. The methodology book will teach you. The book on methodology. My book entitled Methodology for the Study of the Quran. How do you approach the quest for knowledge? You go first of all to the Quran, Gog and Magog, and you want to know about Gog and Magog, and you go to one hadith and the hadith says that only when Nabi Isa alayhi salam returns, at that time Gog and Magog, he'll kill Dajjal and Gog and Magog will be destroyed. So fine, full stop, that's it, full stop. We don't need to study the subject anymore. Gog and Magog will only come at that time. That is disrespect for the Quran. And if you show disrespect for the Quran, you'll pay a price for it. No, you don't begin your study with a hadith. You begin the study with the Quran. And when you have studied all the data in the Quran concerning the subject, and you have brought them together in a harmonious whole. And that is not a task for schoolboys. Eh? You have to be more than a schoolboy to do that. Only then do you turn to the hadith. And when you turn to the hadith, if a hadith is in harmony with the Quran, you accept it. If a hadith is in conflict with the Quran, like you know, Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, wa na'uzu billah min hadha, married a child. He married a child. Yeah? That hadith is in conflict with the Quran, you reject it. If a hadith is neither in harmony with the Quran nor in conflict with the Quran, you accept it but you give it a lower status. It does not have a significant role to play, a critical role to play in the pursuit of knowledge. Please study my book on methodology. Next one. And then you. Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Dari Indonesia.
Indonesia? Masyaallah. Oh, you're the one from Taiwan. Oh, very good. He traveled all the way from Taiwan to come to attend the lecture today, mashallah. The question is, what is my opinion? One question at a time. Okay. The question is, what in my eschatology, my eschatological analysis, is the role of China in the coming Great War? And is there any reference in the Quran to support a role for China in the coming Great War? I do not find in the Quran any evidence pertaining to China directly. But the important thing for us to recognize is that in the Quran we have Qarnayn, Qarnayn. Qarnayn in Surah Al-Kahf can mean two horns, and you don't have to send me any email to convince me it's two horns. If that's your choice, that's your choice. When I look at the word Qarn in the Quran, I find that Allah always uses the word Qarn to mean an age or an epoch, a generation. And so Qarnayn will be two ages or two epochs or two times. One in the past, when Gog and Magog were confined behind the barrier, and the other in the future, when, of course, Gog and Magog will be released. Dhulqarnayn used power to punish the oppressor, to confine him, to check, to use the language of chess, to checkmate the oppressor. Cannot be destroyed, but he can be checkmated. And in the second age, in the Qarnayn, which is to come, Qarnayn, the second age, will witness the same thing again. That a people in the region of the Black Sea, is the Black Sea in the Quran? Is the Black Sea in the Quran? Is the Black Sea in the Quran? Come on, somebody. Yes, it is. The Black Sea is in the Quran. In which surah? In Surah Al-Kahf. Ainun Hamia. Dhulqarnayn reached to one end of the land, Ainun Hamia, meaning a body of water which is dark and murky, and it's the Black Sea. And in that region of the world in which the Black Sea is located, the second age will emerge of Qarnayn. It's two Qarns. That power will emerge in that region of the world. And that power will be built by Allah. Allah will make it powerful. And that power will rest on foundations of faith, not godlessness. And that power will be used in the second Qarn as it was used in the first Qarn, to stand up and resist the oppressor, and to support the oppressed and those who have faith and are righteous in conduct. This is Russia. This is Russia's role today. Russia is turning away from communism, away from Marxism, but there are those who are still sleeping, so let them sleep. And Russia is returning to Orthodox Christianity. Russia is recovering her spiritual soul, while the United States and Canada and Britain and France and Germany have barbarian souls. A man can marry another man and get a marriage certificate, and you call that? You call that something progressive, something worthy of commendation? That's progress? You must be sleepy. If Russia is standing up against the oppressor in the second Quran, then whoever stands with Russia is on the right side. And China is a proud civilization. Not the Chinese in Singapore I'm talking about. I'm talking about China. China will not bend her knee to the oppressor who wants to rule the world. So they're now preparing to wage war not only on Russia but on China as well. They are really stupid people. They're really stupid people. They're preparing to wage war on both Russia and China. Is China afraid? No. Russia says, we're not afraid of you. We are a nuclear power. Don't mess with nuclear Russia, said Putin. Don't mess with nuclear Russia. That's what Putin said. And Russia is not afraid of them. So they're preparing for nuclear war with Russia. And Russia says, we're not afraid of you. And they're preparing for nuclear war with China as well. And China says, we're not afraid of you. Now then, this is a war between the world's greatest oppressor that history has ever known and those who are standing and resisting his oppression. On which side should you be? If you have a telephone to your government, then call them and tell them. Whichever government you have in the world, call them and ask them. If this is a war between the greatest oppressor that the world has ever known and those who are standing up courageously to resist his oppression, whose side should you be on? Should you be sitting on a fence? Not Imran Hosein. No, and not my students. We are on the side of the second Quran in Quranain.
Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam. Okay. Among the countries that I no longer travel to is India. Because while India is a member of BRICS, and India is proud of her friendship and alliance with Russia, India has now become Israel's most strategic ally in the world. I think India is more important than the United States now to Israel. I quoted to you from Suratul Ma'idah, but I only did not quote the whole ayah. I only quoted the second part, that you have to look for those who are going to be your allies. And I said the natural ally is the one who is going to be your natural ally would be the one who is closest in love and affection for you, okay? That is the Suratul Ma'idah, towards the end of the surah. However, before that, the ayah begins with a statement, لَتَجِدَنَّ أَشَدَّ النَّاسِ عَدَاوَةً لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الْيَهُودِ, that you will most certainly find in time to come, as you found at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, his fair Madaria, that those who will be the most hostile of all people to you would be the Jews. This happened in the time of the Prophet ﷺ. And then for 1,000 years after that, we had no problems with the Jews. No. We protected the Jews in our civilization. And then came the emergence of the Zionist movement, at the same time when the body of Fir'aun was discovered. And now the Jews have become the people with the greatest hatred for us, exactly as Allah said in the Quran. But he goes on to say, وَالَّذِينَ أَشْرَكُوا, that in addition to the Jews, there will be another people who will have the greatest hatred in their hearts for you. Now, while there are Hindus whose hearts are not corrupted with hatred for Muslims, while there are Hindus who are sincerely, I don't blame them at all, sincerely puzzled and troubled with 800 years of Muslim rule over Hindu India. And they cannot stomach it. If I was a Hindu, I would also be tremendously troubled over 800 years of Muslim rule over India, because it was not Islam. It was Islamic imperialism ruling over India. And I would oppose it. If I were a Hindu, I would oppose that Muslim rule over India. And if I were an Orthodox Christian, I would hate the Ottoman Empire. Oh, yes. And hate Islam, because this is Islam, Ottoman Empire. If I were an Orthodox Christian, I can't blame the Orthodox Christian for his hatred for Islam because of what the Ottoman Empire did. And I can't blame the Hindu as well. Because what Islam, what these Muslims did, the Mughals, was to impose Islamic imperialism upon India. So yes, you have to make a distinction between those Hindus whose hearts are troubled by this Muslim imperialism, but who are a people who do not have that genital hatred for Islam inside of them. There are another Hindu people who are like that. And Allah is referring to these Hindus. The same way as in Britain, in France, in Germany, you find Christians who are decent people. Yes. You find Christians who don't like what the government is doing at all. And then you find other Christians who are very, very much seeped in hatred for Islam. So Allah is saying in the Quran that in addition to Al-Yahud, there'll be another people who will show the greatest hatred for you in Akhir Zaman, and these are people of Shirk. Hindu India, that part of Hindu India which is hostile to Islam, falls in that category. Any more questions? Yes?
Last question.
Last question. Okay, last question.
Uzbekistan,
mashallah. We have someone else from Uzbekistan here today. Yeah.
I would like to say that I witnessed the time that I was born during the Soviet era, and I witnessed the time that the post-Soviet era also. My question is regarding the part of Constantinople. Is it going to be that the Muslims are going to fight each other? Because currently, Constantinople is the Turkish people, and the majority
okay. Okay, I'll explain to you. To answer your question again, you have to go to the Quran. Always go to the Quran. Allah speaks in the Quran in Surah Al-Ma'idah. And He says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you who have faith in Allah. لا تتخذوا اليهود والنصارى أولياء. Do not take the Jews and do not take the Christians as your friends and allies. Question. Is Allah speaking about all Jews and all Christians? Answer. No, couldn't be. Because in other parts of the Quran, he said the Christians are going to be the closest in love and affection for you. Well, then if Allah is not speaking about all Jews and all Christians, when he said, don't take them as your friends and allies, well, then which Jews and which Christians is he talking about? When he said, don't take them as your friends and allies, the answer to that question is in the words which follow. بَعَدُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ. Do not take such Jews and do not take such Christians as your friends and allies, who themselves become friends and allies of each other. The Quran is anticipating a time which is to come when one part of the Christian world and one part of the Jewish world would mysteriously reconcile and become friends and allies. When that happens, you are tell this to the Turkish Prime Minister for me, no, the Turkish President for me. If you have a telephone call, call him, tell him. Because he doesn't know the Quran. When that happens, you are prohibited from maintaining friendship and alliance with those people. Has that friendship and alliance emerged today? Is there a Judeo-Christian alliance in the world today? Yes, it is. The only ones who can't recognize it are those who drink in tea-tariq and eat in roti chennai and going home to sleep. The rest of us know it. It's a Zionist Judeo-Christian alliance. And they control power in modern Western civilization. Not the French people, not the American people. No. That Judeo-Christian alliance controls power in modern Western civilization. And NATO is their military arm. They're not going to like me in Kosovo. They're not going to like me in Bosnia. They're going to like me in Macedonia. They're not going to like me in Albania, but this is the truth. This is the truth. This is the Quran. So it's time for Albania to wake up, and Macedonia and Bosnia to wake up and tell Bill Clinton to get lost. And tell that to Kosovo as well. If you turn to that Judeo-Christian alliance with friendship and alliance, what's the price you pay? Listen to the Quran. The Quran is absolute authority. You can't challenge the Quran. No. Allah says, وَمَنْ يَتَوَلَّهُ مِنْكُمْ فَإِنَّهُ مِنْهُمْ. Whosoever turns with friendship and alliance to them, you belong to them, not to us anymore. So this is not a civil war between Muslims and Muslims. You have left Islam. When you join NATO, and you are proud and happy to be a member of NATO, and now you're becoming NATO's Trojan horse after the failed coup d'etat. He knew the coup d'etat was coming. He knew that Fethullah Gulen was part of it. He knew that NATO was a part of it. He knew all of that. And he knew that the coup was going to fail, so that he could have a chance now to wipe out all the opposition there is to him in Turkey. So that Turkey is now strong without any internal opposition, so that Turkey could now play a strategic role in anticipation of the war against Russia. We are not fools. Erdogan should know we are not fools. And I hope Putin knows that this is a Trojan horse. So the conquest of Constantinople will come from a civil war. Turkey will have a civil war. On one side will be those who are fighting the oppressor to get NATO out of Constantinople. And on the other side will be the fools, the bunch of fools who is still standing with NATO. I don't know what Bosnia is going to do. Now they're in NATO's embrace and there's no way to get out. I don't know what Albania is going to do. I don't know what Macedonia is going to do. They are in NATO's embrace and there is no way out. They are trapped. So long as they remain where they are, history is going to move and leave them behind. We thank you for your kind attention to the lecture. I have my books outside, and after Maghrib, inshallah, you can get them. We can also autograph them for you.